against me. I'm surrounded on all sides, but I've heard you can part the waters. So in your name, come and turn the tides. I'm staring at this mountain, no chance I'm getting through. But I've heard they can melt before you. So in your name, I'm asking it to move. Let that It is finished, it is done. Yeah, I heard you told death it was over. So in your name, I'll claim this fight is won. The cross stands before me. It is finished, it is done. Yeah, I heard you told death it was over. So in your name, I'll claim this fight is won.
Blessed morning, FGA. Welcome to service.
I used to be a beggar, down on calloused knees, till I got an invitation into the courts of a king. I'm moving on, keep moving. I'm moving on. You gave me my freedom.
Marching up and down to church. What does real really mean? I think about real or being real as something or someone who is exactly what they claim to be and consistently so. This got me thinking about me as a dad. Once a father, always a father. It doesn't matter where I am or who I am surrounded with. I could be running errands at a grocery store or conducting a business meeting or just spending time at home. I'm always a dad, a father in every situation. And as every parent would know, there is no off switch to being a parent. You see, we don't ever stop being a son or a daughter or even a mother, even when we are not doing mothery or fathery things. It's just a part of who we are. In fact, even parents who have kids that have grown up and left still very much identify themselves as parents and go on to become spiritual parents. That parent switch always stays on. But what about our role or identity as a Christian, as a disciple, as the church? Do we have that switch on no matter what? Do we go through life switching it on and off, being a real disciple only when it involves Christiany things? I remember struggling with this whole issue of being real in my own life. I was facing numerous issues in my life. It was also early years in my married life. And I was surrounded by some other believers whose Christian switch seemed to go on and off as they wanted. I remember really struggling with what it meant to be a real, authentic Christian. Then I joined a home fellowship and I got to know my leader. In him, I saw a real Christian. He didn't turn his Christian or discipleship switch on and off. It was always on in every part of his life. There was nothing fake about the Christianity he was living. What you saw was what you got. Everything clicked at that point, and I decided that I wanted to be a real Christian, and that included how I was going to be a husband and a dad. I decided I was going to be real no matter what. You know, the world has had enough of fake Christianity. They don't need another Sunday disciple that knows when to lift their hands and when to shout hallelujah. They don't need a disciple that turns the Christian switch on in church but turns it off in the boardroom, on when speaking with believers and off with everyone else. The world needs to see disciples who would tackle the hard with integrity, love the difficult with patience, and genuinely live out what he or she says they believe. The world needs real, authentic disciples that they may come to know a real and authentic God. Revival starts with real disciples. Revival, my friends, starts with you.
Question mark. This is for the outcast soul, lost control, no one knows. Sing it for the can't go back. Sing it for the broken past. Sing it for the just found out life is now upside down.
If you're looking for hope tonight, raise your hand. If you feel you're fighting the fight of your life, then stand.
not too late.
If you're in the fight of your life, we're gonna make it hand in hand.
I will be by your side, it's love in the air tonight. I'll help you see the light, we're gonna make it together.
Our differences. Together we are bolder, braver, stronger.
Good morning, church. So glad to have you all join us for worship this morning. Just a quick reminder before we start that we will be having communion together later. So please prepare the communion emblems for later. We just want to praise and thank God that, you know, we can still come together online like this Sunday after Sunday. So this week, let's just believe that even as we come together and we lift our voices to just worship God, that we would experience God in a special way this morning. Shall we just commit this time to the Lord in prayer? Hallelujah. Father God, we just want to thank you and bless you, God, that you are a God who is omnipresent, Father, that you are with us, Lord, in our homes, in our cars or wherever we are joining service this morning, Father God. We just want to thank you and bless you, Father, that you promised, Lord, when two or three are gathered, even when we are gathered online, Father, you will be amongst us. So, Father, we just want to commit today's service to you. Come, Lord, come in a special way, Lord, and touch us even as we lift our worship to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church. Welcome for service. We're so glad that you can be here with us. Let's just raise up our voice and our hearts as we worship our God and declare that He is a faithful God.
Thy faithfulness, O God, my
Hallelujah, Lord. Faithfulness, oh God. Lord, we want to thank you that even through our darkest moments, oh God, you are there with us. Your presence never leaves us, oh God. And so we come and enter into your presence this morning, Lord, and we want to worship you, oh God.
You're the glory and the light. I'll sing to you.
for your everlasting love, oh God. And Lord, as bread that is broken, Lord, we ask that you use our lives, oh God. Empower us, oh God, to reach out to those around us, oh God, with the love of Christ. Many hearts are hungry tonight. Many trapped in darkness yearn for the light. So many who are far from home, and many who are lost. Oh Lord, your wounded children need the power of your cross. As bread that is broken, use our lives. As wine that is poured out, a willing sacrifice. Empower us, Father, to share the love of Christ. As bread that is broken, Lord, use our lives. Helps to begin where we are. Help us love the to our hearts, and give our faith a mission field wherever you may call. Lord, love your world through each of us until we've touched them all. As bread that is broken, use our lives. As wine that is poured,
want to thank you Jesus, thank you Lord, thank you for the power of the cross. Hallelujah. The power that has redeemed us so that we too can be like bread that is broken, that our lives too will be like wine that is poured out. Hallelujah. We thank you Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us on that cross. Even as we come together as your people to take communion together, we just want to come, Lord, and ask that you search our hearts. Search our hearts, Lord, and if there are ways that are not pleasing to you, we ask, God, that you would come and cleanse us afresh this morning, God. That even as we come together, that we would come with clean hearts and clean hands, not because of our own goodness, but because of the power of the cross. Lord, so we just want to commend ourselves to you this morning, even as we partake the bread and the wine, that even as we do this together, Lord, we want to remember you. In Jesus' name, amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 verse 23 reads, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's partake the bread together. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Hallelujah. Let's partake of the cup together. The Lord continues to say, "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Let's pray. Father God, we want to thank you and bless you, God, that even as we have taken the bread and drank from the cup, Father, we are proclaiming and we look forward, Lord, to the day when you will come again, Lord, for all of us. And until then, Father, we pray that our lives, Lord, will be like bread that is broken, like wine that is poured out. Use us, Lord. Use us for your kingdom's purpose. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We just want to take this time now to pray for our brothers and sisters who are in need. Wherever you may be this morning, in your homes, in your bedrooms, seated, standing, lying down, the Lord is near. The Lord wants to come and touch us and heal us this morning. So as a congregation that may be meeting not physically together but online together, let's just spend this time to pray and intercede for our brothers and sisters in need. I want to encourage you, you know, if you have a physical ailment, just place your hand on that part that you are looking to God for healing. And if you have an emotional need, a worry, a financial need, just place your hand on your heart. The Lord sees your cry, and together as a church, we want to pray with you today. Let's pray. Father God, you see, Lord, you see the hands raised to you. You see, Lord, the hands that is put on our hearts, oh Father God, and we know, God, that you understand our needs even before we cry out to you, Father. You see us, Lord, in our time of need, and you desire, you promise us, God, that you would come and touch us and heal us, oh Father God. So right now, I pray for each and every person, Father, each and every person that is looking to you, Jesus, for a physical healing, for a financial or an emotional or a mental breakthrough, God. We ask, Jesus, that you would come right now and touch each and every one of us. Father God, set us free in Jesus' name. Free, Lord, from all impediment that would drag us down, that would stop us, Lord, from living that victorious life in you, Jesus. We just ask, God, and we just commit every brother and every sister to you. In Jesus' name, we receive our healing, we receive our provision, we receive our freedom in Jesus' name. Amen. Now we would like together as a congregation to continue to pray for our nation in this very difficult time. Let me read to you Psalm 14 verse 12. "There is a way that seems right to a man, but its end is the way of death." Let's pray together. O God, our Heavenly Father, we pray for both Malaysians and the foreigners in our nation during this time of the COVID-19 crisis. May there be adequate public awareness of the crucial role each one has in flattening the pandemic curve. Let not pandemic fatigue, wrong mindsets, and ignorance result in poor SOP compliance that negate all ongoing efforts to contain the current crisis. We pray for the lower-income urban communities living in crowded, squalid conditions that prevent proper SOP compliance. We also remember rural communities facing similar SOP challenges in villages characterized by communal living in close proximity. Give wisdom to the relevant authorities to work out viable, practical solutions that will reduce virus transmission risk and ensure health safety in such places. Oh God, guard our hearts in this time of pandemic from mindsets that may seem right in our eyes, but will actually endanger ourselves and others. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Even as we continue in our worship, in the giving of our offering, let's just give generously, because the Bible reminds us that everything that we have comes from the Lord. Whether we are giving in our lack or we are giving in our abundance, God loves a cheerful giver. There are two ways that you can give. One is through online banking. The details are on the screen. Or you could scan the QR code and give by touch and go. We are also opening up a Bantuan FGA that for those of you who feel led to just give so that the church can continue to support the community around us. We just want to praise and thank God that over the past month, since we reopened the fund, that we have been able to help many, many families in need. So if you would like, you know, to contribute to that work that FGA is doing to help needy and poor communities, please also look up the bank details for the Bantuan FGA Fund. We want to thank you and bless you for your generous giving. Let's just pray for the offering and for the Bantuan FGA Fund. Father, we want to thank you and praise you. That is, it is only through you that we can give, O Father. And we pray, God, that even as we give back to you a part of everything that you have given to us, Father, we ask that you would just bless the collection, Lord, that you would bless it and multiply the funds that are collected so that we can continue to be a blessing to many of us. Bless every giver, Lord, who have chosen to give cheerfully today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Good morning again, if you've just joined us. And if you are a newcomer, you know, that you have just, no, this may be your first, second or third time joining us on FGA Online, we welcome you. We welcome you in Jesus' name. And for those of you, you know, who have yet to be connected to a small group, a live group, I want to encourage you to just take up your phone or your camera and just scan the QR code so that you can be directed, you know, by someone to join a group near where you are. And also, we just want to give you time for those of you who are listening to us as well. You can click that subscribe button so that you will receive constant updates from us. Okay, there's a couple of videos before that we'd like to play before our speaker comes to us today. And the first, it's a revival video that will be played. So let's turn our attention to that right now.
Malaysia is reimposing a full lockdown on Kuala Lumpur and five states to curb a third wave of COVID-19.
Unemployment in Malaysia has hit a 27-year high. The Merdeka Centre says 5 to 8% more Malaysians will fall into poverty because of the pandemic.
Jesus wants to do something new corporately to transform their community, city and nation.
Years that have gone by, you see the hand of God moving amongst us, and with humility and deep gratitude, we thank the Lord for His good hand upon us.
So, there is an FGA conference coming up real soon. Okay, so our prayer, is that, you know, this conference will spark up a momentum within us as individuals and as a congregation, that we would continue, we would desire, that we would seek to be active disciples, to be real, to be raw, and to be relevant. Okay, registration is already open, so please, please don't wait till the last minute to sign up. It is pretty simple. There is a Google form on FGA's website, and as well as in our church planning app. So you can also scan the QR code on the screen to get to our website. Just fill in your details and block out those dates for the conference today. So church, let's all flood that link and fill up our forms and get registered and expect God to speak to each and every one of us at the conference. But before the conference, okay, there is a very important announcement coming up as well. A very important date. You know, keep that date in your diary. 25th August, Wednesday, 8:30 p.m., which is one of our prayer meeting slots. We are going to have our first online FGA impartation night. So, and we really want to get our hearts ready before the conference. So I encourage you to come and sign up and log in early, you know, and come and together, you know, to really come together and receive God's blessing even as we look to join the conference in September. For this season, I'm sure you guys have enjoyed the video that was played 2 weeks ago about being real. Okay, the challenge was, you know, are we a Christian that switch ourselves on and switch ourselves off? Today, we want to talk about the second R in being real, raw, and relevant. That is, today's topic, the video topic is about being raw. So let's just see what God has to say to us through this video.
What does it mean to be raw? Raw can be defined as being natural, and it also means undisguised. So what does it take for us to be raw? Well, it takes vulnerability. And vulnerability requires trust. We need to be able to trust that if we really come as we are, things will still be okay. Come as we are? Well, that sounds pretty scary. Imagine unlocking your front door and letting people into your home. In some cases, not knowing who you're letting in. There's a good chance that the moment you open that door, a robber might just come in. What then? Or if the people that you let in end up judging you for your messy halls, your cluttered tables, and that's if you open only the front door. What about all the other rooms where you stuff everything in? Personally, I hate being vulnerable. I'd rather cover that up and look like a person that has it all together. I want to appear strong, but not letting anyone look in, it gets really tiring. It feels like I'm living a double life. And sometimes I feel like I'm not honest with myself, I'm not honest with the people around me, and most importantly, I'm not honest with God. So usually, what I would do is that I would keep that door locked until I make myself feel better or look better. Then only I would go to God. And it was until pretty recently when I was reading the book of Matthew again, where Jesus clearly said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Jesus did not say, "Come to me when you feel better or when you have it all together." Being vulnerable invites help. It invites comfort, and it allows us to love and be loved. So, if we are going to be a church, our doors need to be open. And if we are going to be disciples, our lives need to be open. How can the world know that even in the tough times, God is there? How else will they know that God came for those whose houses are messy and unclean? Revival comes when we truly understand that God needs access to our houses. Not just every front door, but every room and even drawers. It happens when we step out in bold vulnerability, to open our entire lives to others, highs and lows, that in all of it, they may see God at work. So let's start putting on vulnerability as our cloak of victory.
Wow, we hope that you have been challenged, you know, to open the hearts of the doors of your heart, to just open our hearts, actually, mine included, you know, that together we can decide to be boldly vulnerable to God and to each other. We can do it, right? Hallelujah. And now I would like to introduce a very special speaker coming to us today. We as a church have been going through the book of Matthew, and I'm sure that we have been blessed for the past many months. Today we are going to look at the story of Jesus walking on water in Matthew chapter 14, verses 22 to 33. When I read that chapter, I asked, can we walk on water as well today? The amazing thing is that, you know, we have a very special speaker, Brother Chiau Haw Choon. Let's hear from him how God took a gangster kampung boy and showed him what it means to walk on water. Let us just listen to his captivating story.
How do you respond to the crisis, especially in this pandemic season? Do you respond to the crisis positively or negatively? Today we will study Matthew chapter 14, 22nd to 33 to see how Peter responds to the crisis. But before we look at how Peter responds to the crisis, first I will share how I respond to the crisis when I was young, and also how God has saved my life. I was born in the small town of Alostar. It was a typical houses where we use ground floor for our hardware shop business. My grandfather started a hardware shop business in this small town, Alostar. And we all, big family, live on the second floor. I was a typical kampung boy. Never been to a big city, not even mentioned Kuala Lumpur. When I was about at primary five, our whole family moved from this kampung, small town, to a big city, Alostar. To me, Alostar was a big city back then. But at the age of 13 to 14 years old, I dropped off from school. I was... Why I dropped off from school at such a young age? I became a gangster. I was a drug addict. Besides cocaine, I basically have tried out all the drugs. And at the age of 14 years old, I think 15 years old, I have even witnessed someone being murdered in front of me. How would you imagine if today your kids are also like that? Obviously, my family very disappointed about me, and they couldn't do anything about me. My life was upside down. I would always sleep in the morning, wake up at night, you know. My activity would just started at the night time. That's my life at such a young age. I have never seen anyone worse than me back then. Very obvious, my entire family have very disappointed about me. My father is the eldest in the family, and I'm also the eldest in my family. Being the eldest is supposed to represent responsibility and also as a role model. But obviously, I wasn't that role model for my family member. I didn't attend secondary school. One day, my mom was asking me, would I want to study a basic English for a couple of months in Singapore. Back then, I don't even know how to speak any basic English. When I was young in primary school, I attended Chinese primary school. Soon after 1 year, I attended second school and I have already dropped out from school. I thought to myself, since there was nothing for me to play in Alosta, myself changed a new playground in Singapore. That was my thought. And without really hesitating, I decided to go to Singapore to play. I went to Singapore. I was required to stay in a Singaporean house as she played as a guardian to take care of me. I attended a language school to study those basic English. I still remember at the age of 16 years old, the first few English words I learned was eat, at, eaten. Wow. I was only realized it has three different ways of written it. Besides attending intensive language school, I also attend a tuition center, which was just 5 minutes walking distance from my house. I remember the tuition, this particular tuition teacher, besides she will teach me those basic mathematics and English, she will spend about 1-2 hours to hold me back for 1-2 hours to share the gospel to me. I was very curious. Not so much of curious about this religion. It's more curious about why she has patience on me. To me, back then, Christianity was one of the religions that believed by Masale back then. And I told to myself, no harm for me to have a look, to pay a visit. That's how one of the weekend I went to this half an hour walking distance church. I remember I couldn't understand much what was the pastor preaching about. I believe it was because due to the low education, my intellectual thinking was weak. But there one thing that happened was I found peace in the church. And the feeling was very new and unique to me. And I decided to visit the same church again in the next couple of months. And I decided to give my life to God. That was the first time in my life I have a self-reflection. I look around myself. I have never seen anyone worse than me back then. A typical Malaysian teenager who studied at secondary school. And I was school dropout. I was a drug addict. I was a gangster. And I have little friends surrounded me. All my friends are those, you know, bad company outside. I told to myself, since I have already came to Singapore, I give my life to God. I decided to start over my life again. So on the same year, I continue my intensive language study. And at the end of the year, I went for the exam, tried to admitted to Singapore Secondary School. I remember I went to 7th Secondary School for the exam. I would guess that I failed all the exam. But by God's grace, one school decided to accept me. Next year, I was so excited. First day in school, I was 17 years old. The moment I came to the school, I realized I was the eldest student in the entire school. My schoolmate was about this high only. In Singapore secondary school education, you can complete in 4 years' time or 5 years' time. And most of them have complete their second school in 4 years' time. And at the age of 17 years old, at the secondary one, that was a big embarrassment for me. But I was really dedicated that I want to at least finish my secondary school. I feel fortunate that without a basic English foundation, I able to finish my secondary school in 4 years' time. That was the first achievement for me. Wow. By the time I finished my secondary school, most of my friends have already finished their university. And I told to myself, I want to be like my friend. At least to have a degree. So I decided to set the second goal in my life, to further my study in Melbourne. That's how I went to Melbourne to study for my finance and marketing. I know that when I studied in Melbourne, I know I couldn't fail, you know. I was a little much behind a lot of my friends, you know, back in Malaysia. I studied very hard. And I know that I wasn't a smart student. So every time when I come to the exam, I will lock myself in the library morning until evening to make sure that I'm able to memorize, to know all the subject very well. While in my last year, which was just 13, 14 years ago, one day I received a phone call from my family that my father wasn't feeling well. And they wanted me to go back to Malaysia to accompany him and also to look after the business. That's how I came back to Malaysia. I completed my last year in Penang in studying in this district college. District college was having a twinning program with my university in Melbourne. You can see that I don't have any working experience. The probably one thing that I did it very well was being a gangster. Or I only work in the restaurant as a waitress when I studied in Melbourne. Literally, I don't have any working experience. And neither nor I have managing anyone else before. When I came back, that's how I went into my father's cement trading business. Never is a God grace that in this 10 years' time, we have grown the business into 4 listed companies. We did 2 IPO and 2 acquisition of the other 2 listed companies. And today, we have more than 2,000 employees. We are in the business sector of trading and manufacturing of building materials, property development, construction, renewable energy, and home and living. It's definitely not coming from myself. And it wasn't God that I would have died on the street like many of my friends did. When I was young, you can see that I was in a deep crisis. No one would ever imagine that this young boy, after 10 over years, would become a successful entrepreneur. And it was God that who caught me from the water, like what he did to Peter. Let us read Matthew chapter 14, 22nd to 33, and see how Peter responds to the crisis. Immediately, Jesus made the disciple get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went out on the mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone, and the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the wave because the wind was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage. It is I. Don't be afraid." "Lord, if it's you," Peter replied, "tell me come to you on the water." "Come," he said. Then Peter go down out of the boat, walked on the water and came towards Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid and beginning to sink and cry out, "Lord, save me." Immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith," he said, "why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are Son of God." You can see that even after the disciple has been watching Jesus preaching to thousands, drive out demon, feed thousands of people with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, yet they still don't believe Jesus is God. And they even say that Jesus is ghost. So it also means that if today Jesus came to this world now, perform a miracle, there are still people who don't believe Jesus is God. So in this John chapter 20 and 29, blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. And we are the blessed one. We believe, but yet we have not seen it. You see, Jesus is such a patient person, he didn't angry. If I were him, I would throw angry to the man. You know, I would scold them that, "You guys have been watching me perform miracle, and now today, you guys say that I'm ghost." Jesus didn't angry. Instead, he even comforted them, immediately said to them, "Take courage. It is I. Don't be afraid." And Peter still doubt and ask, "Lord, if it's you, let me come to you on the water." I truly like Peter. I feel that I was like him. Whenever thing came to my mind, I would want to do it immediately, straight away, act on it. And Peter is such a person. Then Peter got down from the boat and walked on the water and came toward Jesus. But when the moment he lost the focus on Jesus, instead of seeing the wave and the wind, he started to sing and cry out for help. Because he was afraid. He was terrified because he saw the big wave and wind. It showed that it wasn't the big wave or wind that bring the crisis to Peter. It was his emotion. In fact, I realized that right now, the situation that we are in, it was exactly like Peter. Whenever we see it's all the big wave and wind, it's all the negative news that we heard. But it's not that the crisis that brings us now. It is the emotion that brings us now. It was like a Peter. It was the emotion that he lost the faith on God. But the God is always in front of us and waiting for us to walk on the water towards Him. And He speaks to us and say, take courage, it is I. Don't be afraid. When I was 23 years, when I was told that my father was not feeling well, I was told to come back to Malaysia. I very hesitate because it took me so much effort to start over again at the age of 17 years old. I'm not sure, should I stop my study in Melbourne and come back to Malaysia? I was afraid. I'm unsure. But it was a prayer that I heard God spoke to me. Don't be afraid, for I'm with you. Whenever you go, I'm with you. I took the promise. I came back to Malaysia. It was later I realized God has so much abundant thing has planned ahead of me. Until today, God still speaks to me, do not be afraid, for I'm with you. Because He knows that I have a little faith. He knows that whenever I see the strong wind and wave, I will start to sing and cry out for help. But I know that as long as I have faith and put my eye on Him, I shall be able to walk on the water again. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for showing us. It wasn't that the crisis that bring us now. It is the emotion that bring us now. Lord, please continue to strengthen us that we will have continue to have faith on you, that we know that you are always there for us. We will always hear you say, do not be afraid, for I am with you. Let us focus on you, Lord. We all know that in this crisis, we are afraid. There's so much things are uncertain. But Lord, we know that you are there for us. Whenever we sing, we know that you were always there to bring us out. Thank you, Lord, that in the name of Jesus, amen.
Thank you, Brother Haw Choon, for that amazing and powerful testimony. I trust that every one of you, me included, have been truly encouraged that no matter what storm that we may be in, Jesus is here. Jesus is here to help us to come out of that storm. Just as the disciples in verse 24, Matthew chapter 14, we read that they were tossed by the sea and the wind was blowing hard against them. You know, many of us, me included, you know, are facing storms of life, you know, be it a health storm, an emotional issue, a moral storm, an economical storm. You know, what we have heard today, I trust, would encourage us to hold on to God, because just as Jesus invited Peter to walk on water, Jesus is inviting us to also step out of our comfort zone. That, you know, whether we are coming out of a storm or whether we are entering a storm, or most of us, we are probably in the middle of the storm, Jesus is the answer. You know, through the story of what Brother Haw Choon has shared, right? I mean, who would ever imagine that God would take a gangster kampong boy and make him successful, not in his own right, but because he puts his trust in Jesus? You know, as I listen to Brother Haw Choon, I'm reminded of three things about being in the storm. You know, when we face the storms of life, It should remind us of the promises of God. When Jesus told the disciples to go to the other side, I'm sure he made a promise to them that he will meet them on the other side, you know, and we know that if the disciples listened to Jesus and if they held on, you know, and they held on to his words, they would know that they do not need to be afraid when they face the storm. They would probably enjoy the storm even as they look towards being reunited with Jesus again. So, I mean, there are so many promises in the Word of God that we can hold on to. You know, one particular one is Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5. You know, God reminds us that, you know, Jesus tells us that I will never leave you nor forsake you. So, you know, in this very, very difficult time, you know, let's just hold on to the promises that can be found in the Word of God, that, you know, Jesus will never fail us. Jesus will come to us. A second point that I was reminded of when I was listening to Brother Haw Choon is that, you know, even when we cannot see Jesus, he sees us through the storm. You know, can you imagine the disciples being in that boat? All they could see was the waves and the winds, you know, but yet Jesus was on that mountaintop. And Jesus being omniscient, I'm sure Jesus knows how deep the water was, how high that wind, how rough was the waves that were tossing that boat. You know, just like the disciples, we may not be able to see beyond the storm that is before us. But let us put our trust in Jesus, that, you know, Jesus sees our deepest need. Jesus sees us in our most difficult time. I remembered, you know, when I received my cancer diagnosis, you know, it was as if my whole world caved in. I was at the peak of my career. How can this be, Lord? The doctors must have made a mistake. You know, I just want to encourage you, you know, and just as God saw me through my storm for 2 years from 2017 and 2018, just as God saw Brother Haw Choon through his storm of the past, you know, 30 over years, you know, God brought him up. God saw Brother Haw Choon before Brother Haw Choon saw God, you know, and that is the same wherever you are. If you think that you cannot see through your storm, just hold on to the promises of God, because Jesus sees you in your storm. And thirdly, a third thought that came to my mind as I was listening to that testimony is that Jesus comes to us at the right time. We read in verse 25 that Jesus came at 4 a.m. in the morning, you know, and that is the time that some people would liken it to be the darkest hour of the day. Jesus came just in time, you know, and I just want to encourage all of us today. You know, we may be going through really difficult economic situations. Our health is deteriorating. We are losing our loved ones, you know, and just like the disciples, in their most desperate need, in their most desperate moment, Jesus came and calmed the storm for them. So I am encouraged today, even as we remember, you know, what Jesus did so many, many years ago in that storm for his disciples. Jesus will do for us today. Jesus is here with us. You know, Jesus is giving us an opportunity. You know, just when, as the disciples, we read in the passage today, when the disciples first saw Jesus coming to them walking on water, they thought, oh no, that is a ghost. Right? And they doubted that that was really Jesus. But today, you know, Jesus helped them overcome their doubt. And today as well, Jesus is giving us an opportunity that in our storm, when we think, you know, that we cannot do it anymore, when we think, you know, that God, where are you? Jesus will turn out for us. You know, Brother Haw Choon was actually reminding us, it is not the crisis that will bring us down, it is our emotions. So this morning, I just want to remind all of us to take courage. You know, there is so many things to be afraid of in the future. You know, there is so many uncertainties ahead of us. But we know that we can anchor our hope, you know, in Jesus, because He is that rock that will never move. He is the living God who promises us that we too can walk on waters. So I just want to speak to some of you who are hearing this and thinking, oh man, who is this Jesus? I want to know this Jesus too. I want to give you this opportunity. Whatever storm that you may be in, big or small, Jesus is here. Jesus is here to reach out His hand to you. And Jesus is saying, come, come to me and I will help you out of that storm. If you are that person listening to this right now, I encourage you to just open up your heart and invite Jesus in, into your heart. Invite Jesus into your storm so that He will help you walk through that storm. Can I just ask you to just follow me in this very simple prayer in inviting Jesus to be the Lord of your life and to invite Him to come into your heart. Let's just pray together. Lord Jesus, I thank You that Your body was broken for me, that Your blood was poured out for me. Today, God, I want to invite You into my heart so that I can walk through this storm, not alone, but together with You. I ask You, Lord Jesus, to forgive me of my past sin. From this day forward, Lord, I choose to make You Lord of my life. I choose, Lord, to invite You to into my life to walk with me. This day, Lord, I desire, Father, to walk with You through the storm. Lord Jesus, I thank You. I thank You and I declare You as Lord of my life. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Congratulations. If you have said that prayer, you know, please reach out to one of our pastors online. You can scan the QR code and talk to someone so that there'll be someone who can help you and guide you on the journey ahead. I want to speak to our brothers and sisters who are finding it really difficult during this storm. You know, Brother Haw Choon also reminded us in John chapter 20, blessed are those who have not seen and have believed. I want to challenge you this morning. Even if you cannot see, if you cannot see that light at the end of this dark tunnel, let's just choose to believe that we have a God that is bigger than any problem that we have. We have a God that is bigger than the storm that we are in. We have a group of pastors and church leaders that are waiting to minister to you. So I want to encourage you as well, if you are needing someone to come alongside you to pray with you, please also scan the QR code on the screen and it will take you to a breakout room where somebody will be there to listen to you, to pray with you. Hallelujah. And if you want to also leave a prayer request on a Google form, you can also do that. So just click on the link and leave your prayer request and a pastor from church will get in touch with you in the coming week. Amen. Hallelujah. Even as we draw this week's service to an end, I just want to remind us that we have exciting speakers in October. Next week, we have Pastor Sydney Mohidi all the way from Jakarta, you know, and I think most of us would have sung his songs. You know, he's a powerful worship leader and preacher from JPCC in Indonesia. So please put a reminder on your phone and join us next week for service. So let's just look to the Lord even as we close service today. Father God, we just want to thank You and bless You that You are a God who never changes, that You are a God who never leaves us nor forsakes us, even when we doubt ourselves, Father. And we thank You that even when we doubt You, that You promise that You would never leave us nor forsake us. So today, God, even as You have blessed us in service today, even as we look forward to the week ahead, Father, we look to You, Lord. We look to You, God, and we just want to commit our week to You. Hallelujah, Lord. And we pray right now, may the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us this day and forevermore. In Jesus' name, amen.